it's a whole part of me, an open wound scar to see.
Part 1.
You will hear a woman talking on the telephone to a man about a car he is selling. First, you have some time to look at questions 1 to 4. Now we shall begin. You should answer the questions as you listen, because you will not hear the recording a second time. Listen carefully and answer questions 1 to 4.
Hello, Brian Park speaking.
Oh, hello. I'm calling about the advert in the paper.
For the car?
Yes, the Mini you've got advertised for sale.
Oh, yes.
I just wanted to find out a bit more information.
Of course. What would you like to know?
It's my brother who's interested, actually. But he's not in today, so he asked me to call you.
Fine.
Great, thanks. So, it's a Mini?
Yep.
And how old is it?
Just coming up to 13 years old.
And I seem to remember from the ad that it's grey.
That's it. Doesn't show the dirt.
Absolutely. Anyway, the colour shouldn't be a problem for Jeff. You know, the important thing is the quality.
Yes, of course.
And what about mileage? With it being pretty old, it's probably over 100,000?
Actually, it's 40,000 less than that. 62,000 on the clock.
Great. I remember now. I'm confusing it with another ad I was looking at.
Right. Pleasant surprise then.
Yeah. Have you been the only owner, or was there a previous one?
I'm the second one. Before, it was owned by a teacher, who was a very careful driver, didn't have any accidents.
Very good. And what about you? What do you tend to use it for?
I haven't used it all that much, mostly for shopping. You know, this sort of thing.
So not much wear and tear. I'll make a note of that. I know Jeff wanted me to check that.
Right.
Before you hear the rest of the conversation, you have some time to look at questions 5 to 10. Now listen and answer questions 5 to 10.
Now, about the price, I see you've got it down as £1,250. I'm not sure Jeff will be able to come up with that amount.
In the ad, I did say £1,250 or nearest offer.
So, would you be prepared to go down to £1,000?
That's really too low, I'm afraid.
£1,100?
I might be able to go to that.
OK, I'll make a note of that. What about tax? Is it due soon?
Got another 5 months before it's due.
Oh, that's a real plus, yes. I'll make a note of that.
OK.
Now, you say it's in good condition.
For its age, I'd say yes, definitely. It's just been serviced and there were no major problems.
Major?
I'd be able to show you the service report. The only thing is, you'd have to get a new tyre in the near future. Though it's still okay, you know. It's certainly absolutely safe at the moment.
Okay, fair enough. Yes, I understand.
And the garage also mentioned that one headlight could probably do with replacing. They think there's a fault there, you know, intermittent...
Well, we'd obviously look at all the documents, but that sounds very straightforward.
Of course. I've got all the service documents up to date, and you can look at those.
Well, it all sounds pretty good, and I know my brother will be interested, so would it be possible for him to see the car? He's back from his trip tomorrow, and away tonight, so how about tomorrow?
Tomorrow? Wednesday? I'm afraid that's not possible. I'm out pretty much all day.
Well, Thursday then?
That'd be fine, yeah.
In the morning?
Yes, that'd suit me perfectly.
Great.
Now, you'll need my address.
Oh, yes, of course. What is it?
It's number 238.
238?
London Road.
Oh, that's easy enough.
Yes, very straightforward.
So I'll pass on these notes to Jeff, and he'll see you in a couple.
That is the end of part one.
You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Now turns to part two.
Part two.
You'll hear a tutor and two students discussing modern European writers.
First, you have some time to look at questions 11 to 16. Now, listen carefully and answer questions 11 to 16.
Okay, so to continue our look at modern European writers who have focused on the future in their work, today we're talking about H.G. Wells. Last week, I asked you both to do some background research on Wells, which we're going to discuss now. Geetanjali, tell us about H.G. Wells.
Right. So, H.G. Wells was a hugely successful British science fiction writer. Writing at the end of the 19th and the start of the 20th century, and much of his work focused on predicting the future.
Jason, do you think Wells was just using the future as a narrative device in his fiction?
No. He really believed we can predict the future. In fact, he gave a speech at the Royal Institution in London in 1902, called The Discovery of the Future. And the point he was making was that by looking at what you know about the present and about science, it's quite possible to predict the future.
Indeed. Geetanjali, do you think Wells was always optimistic in his predictions?
Not at all. In fact, he varied in his predictions from being extremely pessimistic about the future to being optimistic. Interestingly, one theory I read links the attitude in Wells's work to his own health. When he was writing The Time Machine, which was published in 1895, he'd just been diagnosed with an incurable fatal disease. Not surprisingly, the book is very pessimistic. Being about a dystopia in the future, a long time in the future, the year 802701, in fact, where there are two races on Earth, the Morlocks and the Eloa, and the Morlocks actually eat the Eloa.
I thought it was interesting, though, that it was H.G. Wells who actually came up with the phrase time machine. So despite being pessimistic, the work has had a lasting effect on our culture.
Right. After the time machine, though, H.G. Wells didn't die, of course. And his recovery might be why he began to be a bit more optimistic about the future.
So that brings us to his first utopia, Anticipations. Jason, tell us about that.
Well, Anticipations, or to give it its full title, Anticipations of the Reaction of the Mechanical and Scientific Progress upon Human Life and Scientific Thought, was published in 1901 and was set in the New Republic of the year 2000. Some of the things Wells predicts are fairly close to our reality today, including 24-hour news, global telecommunications, and even a European Union.
We'll come back to the accuracy of Wells' predictions a little later. Gitanjali, how was Wells' work received at the time?
Well, although Wells was extremely successful, not everyone respected his work or his predictions. Another well-known science fiction writer, Jules Verne, viciously attacked him for works such as The First Man in the Moon, which Verne argued weren't rooted in scientific fact at all.
That's right. Now, Wells wrote a number of other utopian visions of the future. Jason?
Yes. In A Modern Utopia, published in 1905, his vision was of a world where there's no private property, where everyone has access to wonderful healthcare, and interestingly, where everyone's personal information is stored on cards in a central database outside Paris. Apart from the healthcare, I'm not sure everyone today would see that as a positive view of the future.
Neither am I. And, on a similar note, Wells strongly believed in population control, and in The Shape of Things to Come, which was published in 1933, he sees and supports a world where the population is kept at 2 billion. Once again, I'm not sure most people today would necessarily see that as a good thing.
Before you hear the rest of the talk, you have some time to look at questions 17 to 20. Now listen and answer questions 17 to 20.
Gitanjali, in your research, did you come across anything about the world brain?
Yes, I did. It's actually very interesting. Throughout the 1930s, Wells predicted and supported the setting up of a huge world encyclopedia. And towards the end of the decade, in 1938, he wrote a series of essays called World Brain. In these essays, he called for the world to make use of modern technology to create an enormous global encyclopedia so that all our knowledge is available to all people, not just an educated elite. Wells envisioned this as probably being on microfilm. He thought it would allow anyone, anywhere in the world, to look at any book or any document. He also thought it would be created by everyone, once again, not just by an elite.
Yes, and as you can imagine, many people today say that the internet has basically fulfilled his prediction. Of course, it doesn't use microfilm, but essentially, it does meet all Wells's main requirements.
That is the end of part two.
You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Now it turns to part three.
Part three.
You will hear two conversations. Are based on the following conversation. The answer should be appropriate to the content of this conversation.
First, you have some time to look at questions 21 to 25. Now listen carefully and answer questions 21 to 25.
Oh, hi Dave. Long time no see.
Hi Maria. I just settled down. I thought I'd drop by.
Come on in, take a seat. Would you like anything to drink? I have Sprite and orange juice.
Sprite would be fine. Oh, so how have you been?
Oh, not bad. And you?
Oh, I'm doing okay, but school has been really busy these days, and I haven't had time to relax.
By the way, what's your major?
Hotel management.
Well, what do you want to do once you graduate?
I haven't decided for sure, but I think I'd like to work for a hotel or travel agency in this area. How about you?
Well, when I first started college, I wanted to major in French, but I realised I might have a hard time finding a job using the language, so I changed my major to computer science. With the right skills, landing a job in the computer industry shouldn't be too difficult.
So, do you have a part-time job to support yourself through school?
Well, fortunately for me, I received a 4-year academic scholarship that pays for all of my tuition and books.
Wow, that's great.
Yeah, how about you? Are you working your way through school?
Yeah, I work 3 times a week at a restaurant near campus.
Oh, what do you do there?
I'm a cook.
How do you like your job?
It's okay. The other workers are friendly and the pay isn't bad.
Before you hear the rest of the talk, you have some time to look at questions 26 to 30. Now listen and answer questions 26 to 30.
Several days later, Dave and Maria met on campus. So what do you want to do tomorrow?
Well, let's look at this city guide here. Here's something interesting. Why don't we first visit the art museum in the morning?
OK, I like that idea. And where do you want to have lunch?
How about going to an Indian restaurant? The guide recommends one downtown, a few blocks from the museum.
Now that sounds great. After that, what do you think about visiting the zoo? Well, it says here that there are some very unique animals not found anywhere else.
Well, to tell the truth, I'm not really interested in going there. Yeah, why don't we go shopping instead? There are supposed to be some really nice places to pick up souvenirs.
No, I don't think that's a good idea. We only have a few traveller's checks left, and I only have $50 left in cash.
No problem. We can use your credit card to pay for my clothes.
Oh, no. I remember the last time you used my credit card for your purchases.
Oh, well. Let's take the subway down to the seashore and walk along the beach.
Now, that sounds like a wonderful plan.
That is the end of part 3.
You now have half a minute to check your answers.
Now it turns to part 4.
Part 4.
Hear an extract from a talk given by a lecturer from Management Department of a university on the topic Job Satisfaction.
First, you have some time to look at questions 31 to 40. Now listen carefully and answer questions 31 to 40.
Job satisfaction is how happy an individual is with his or her job. Scholars and human resource professionals generally make a distinction between effective job satisfaction and cognitive job satisfaction. Effective job satisfaction is the overall extent of pleasurable emotional feelings individuals have about their jobs and is different from cognitive job satisfaction, which is the extent of individual satisfaction with particular facets of their jobs such as pay, pension, arrangements, working hours, and numerous other aspects of their jobs. At its most general level of conceptualization, job satisfaction is simply how content an individual is with his or her job. Effective job satisfaction is usually defined as a one-dimensional, subjective construct representing an overall emotional feeling individuals have about their job as a whole. Hence, effective job satisfaction for individuals reflects the degree of pleasure or happiness their job in general induces. Cognitive job satisfaction is usually defined as being a more objective and logical evaluation of various facets of a job. As such, cognitive job satisfaction can be one-dimensional if it comprises evaluation of just one aspect of a job, such as pay or maternity leave, or multidimensional if two or more facets of a job are simultaneously evaluated. Environmental factors. One of the most significant aspects of an individual's work in a modern organization concerns the management of communication demands that he or she encounters on the job. Demands can be characterized as a communication load. Individuals in an organization can experience communication overload and communication underload, which can affect their level of job satisfaction. Communication overload can occur when an individual receives loads of message in a short period of time, which can result in unprocessed information, or when an individual faces more complex messages that are more difficult to process. Due to this process, given an individual's style of work and motivation to complete a task, when more inputs exist than outputs, the individual perceives a condition of overload which can be positively or negatively related to job satisfaction. In comparison, communication underload can occur when messages or inputs are sent below the individual's ability to process them. According to the ideas of communication overload and underload, if an individual does not receive enough input on the job or is unsuccessful in processing these inputs, the individual is more likely to become dissatisfied, aggravated, and unhappy with their work that leads to a low level of job satisfaction. Superior subordinate communication. Superior subordinate communication is an important influence on job satisfaction in the workplace. The way in which subordinates perceive a superior's behavior can positively or negatively influence job satisfaction. Communication behavior, such as facial expression, eye contact, vocal expression, and body movement, is crucial to the superior-subordinate relationship. Nonverbal messages play a central role in interpersonal interactions with respect to impression formation, deception, attraction, social influence, and emotional bonding. Individuals who dislike and think negatively about their supervisor are less willing to communicate or have motivation to work, whereas individuals who like and think positively of their supervisor are more likely to communicate and are satisfied with their job and work environment. A supervisor who uses nonverbal immediacy, friendliness, and open communication lines is more likely to receive positive feedback and high job satisfaction from a subordinate. Strategic employee recognition. Employee recognition is not only about gifts and points. It's about changing the corporate culture in order to meet goals and initiatives, and most importantly, to connect employees to the company's core values and beliefs. Strategic employee recognition is seen as the most important program, not only to improve employee retention and motivation, but also
to positively influence the financial situation. The vast majority of companies want to be innovative, coming up with new products, business models, and better ways of doing things. However, innovation is not so easy to achieve. A CEO cannot just order it, and so it will be achieved. You have to carefully manage an organization so that, over time, innovations will emerge. Individual factors. Mood and emotions form the effective element of job satisfaction. Moods tend to be long-lasting, but often weaker states of uncertain origins, while emotions are often more intense, short-lived, and have a clear object or cause. Positive and negative emotions were also found to be significantly related to overall job satisfaction. It was found that suppression of unpleasant emotions decreases job satisfaction, and the amplification of pleasant emotions increases job satisfaction. There are two personality factors related to job satisfaction: alienation and locus of control. Employees who have an internal locus of control and feel less alienated are more likely to experience job satisfaction, job involvement, and organizational commitment. The characteristics like high self-esteem, self-efficacy, and low neuroticism are also related to job satisfaction.
I've got an itch I can't scratch, I'm missing a piece that completes a whole part of me, an open wound scar to see. Everybody come here, gather round, welcome to the freak show, the best in town.